Hi, this is What the Flicks review of Fear the Walking Dead, Tim, Alonzo, Francis. This is episode 6 of season 2, Sicut Cervus. Am I Latining that correctly?
Yeah, close enough. It's a dead language. I saw quite a few theories online about what all that means. You want to walk us through it real
quick? Yeah, sure. Sicut Cervus is a Latin song, assumedly the one they were singing in the church to begin with. I don't speak Latin, so I don't know. It's from Psalms 41:22. The short version is that it goes basically, as the deer longs for springs of water, so my soul thirsts for you, my God.
Yes. So the title of this episode is basically Thirsts the Deer, I think?
Yes. Thirsty Deer.
Yeah.
This episode is thick with religious imagery. The whole opening segment with the Catholic Church and the rite of communion reminded me, oh yeah, it's an interesting metaphor here because, you know, in Catholicism is the belief that that transubstantiation occurs and that when you are receiving the host, you are receiving the literal body of Christ.
Body of Christ, yeah.
So, you know,
not symbolic,
right,
literal.
Exactly. Yeah. So people like to make the whole joke about, you know, the zombie Jesus at Easter or whatever. But, you know, there's the whole life and death issues obviously are essential to the show and play into a lot of religion as well. And now that we're in Mexico, of course, we get to bring in the whole Day of the Dead thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the notion that the dead are always among us. So that's also, you know, I like how they're playing with that stuff.
Yeah, I like the episode. It was a very spiritual episode, and it's a theme that will probably become up more so as we go forward in the season. It's because it's a common reaction. This is why we like the show, because you try to put it into realistic terms. If something like this was to happen, even if something drastic happens in the world, we often pose that question to ourselves or to other people, is if there really is a God out there, then why is this horrible thing happening? And it's interesting in this show to see how these religious characters react to this, whether they channel their religion as a means to bear with it, or whether they discard their religion as a means to cope. We've seen this in The Walking Dead, where many characters actually had to get rid of their past beliefs in order to survive in that world, because the more they stayed true to their religion, the more they started to basically look at situations differently, maybe give certain scenarios the benefit of the doubt instead of just going in and doing what has to be done to be necessary. So I think it was interesting to pose that question and to tie it back to Daniel, I believe, who is still the most interesting character for me at this moment.
Well, let's abandon Philosophy 101 for just one second. Do a recap of the episode. The group gets to the rendezvous point at the assumed Mexican flotilla. Luis does not make it through that. The deal does not go well, even with the group hiding below. They arrived at the villa, but Thomas has been bitten earlier in the episode during a scuffle at the church, as everyone starts bleeding from their eyes quite
right.
Iconically.
I would say that's also a big thing for the Catholic, the statues of saints that bleed from the eye. It's, mm-hmm. it's a popular form of stigmata.
So our group meets Celia, whose hospitality has a dark secret.
Mm. Interesting.
Who is Luis's mother?
Mother, yes.
Okay,
and
yes.
Thomas's sort of mother figure.
Right. I was very drawn by the scene of Strand and Abigail, with Strand sort of trying to encourage him to go into the light, basically to allow himself to die. And that scene has a really potent imagery especially because both characters are gay men. It calls to mind, for me at least, certainly the movie Longtime Companion. There's that iconic scene where Bruce Davison's character is talking his partner through the death process and telling him that it's okay to let go and to loosen up and to basically just allow himself to expire. And, you know, there is you can read an AIDS metaphor into this show if you want to. It's about this sort of sudden horrible plague and people are dying left and right and there's no one's quite sure how to deal with it, mm-hmm. and that sort of thing. So to have, you know, two gay men in this situation where one of them is dying and the other one is not only resigned to the fact that his partner is dying, but trying to sort of help him in that process and kind of selflessly saying, look, I love you and it's going to be hard for me when you're gone, but you're suffering, you need to go and push off now. That scene, I thought, really brought a lot of that back for me.
So the thing about I liked about that specific scene with Strand is that it seems like I've been grasping to try and get this personal connection to Strand. I think that he is an interesting character and I've wanted to feel sorry for him, and in that situation I definitely did. And I think that I was surprised, I don't know whether they're going to explore that in the next episode, is that he probably has every right to, I would say, hold a grudge against the fellow members of the group, because he's always been the one to push forward first. Like, we need to get to the situation. And if they, perhaps he's maybe going to beat himself up, we don't know yet, as to whether or not they did things a little bit differently if he got there sooner. Because you could see that he started to allude to that. He was like, maybe if I got to you sooner. And of course, his partner was letting him know that that wasn't the case, that this was going to happen anyway. But I'm interested to see how the dynamic shifts with him, because he seems to be still, you can tell that he admires Madison, and he admires what she likes to do to get things done. Like, when she comes in, he's like, do we like her? And she's like, she's fierce. Mm-hmm. So you can tell he admires that. But for me, if it's in that situation, he could hold a grudge.
And the next time somebody disagrees with him, I think he's going to be like, well, you know what? We got here late. And that's because I listened to you guys. So fuck off for doing it my way.
I want to talk about the biggest criticism of the episode that I've read, and this is the farm again with Herschel that you don't know about. Mm-hmm. And this is the governor again that you don't know about. But that's people are saying this is the same plot that we've seen twice already. Why are we doing it again? And I think it works best in this instance. I think the writers of The Walking Dead sort of played their hand a little bit too early with that plot line, because it really fits with the Day of the Dead and Santa Muerta and the beliefs of those people. And I think that Celia's, we're not sure what her motivations are yet, but she seems to be, collecting these people in order to, facilitate the next step in life and death. She feeds the poisoned communion wafers to the people in the church to usher them on, much like Santa Muerta does in the iconography. Thank you.
But in that weird way that it's not, she's, because of the scenario that we're in, she's killing them, but they're still around.
Right. Yeah.
Which is a whole other level of.
And on that note, I read those criticisms as well, and I think that it's pointless to make that argument, because it's as if there's these set categories of how you're supposed to deal with the post-apocalyptic world. You're supposed to just get over it and just go complete badass, which we've seen some people do in The Walking Dead, or you need to go and find these different ways to do it, such as the governor in The Walking Dead, where he didn't want to accept the fact that his daughter had become a walker, so he tried to preserve her. But you can't just come up with different methods to make it different from The Walking Dead, because people will still react the same way, if you get what I mean. People are still going to, especially religious people, are still going to try and preserve and still going to try and stay true to what is sacred to them, so that they don't abandon everything that connects them to the previous world. So I don't agree with those complaints. This is what the show is about. It's about tying it to culture and how different people in certain situations will react. And I think that I completely agree that when they go to Mexico and they see a place that's heavily drenched in Catholicism, then they're going to stick to those beliefs. And maybe that will cause a problem. As you said, she doesn't completely understand, I don't think, what her role is yet. She sees herself as being someone to help people move on, but at the same time, she doesn't understand that she's probably going to hurt them in the long run in doing so.
Yeah, you could probably do an entire other spin-off of this show set in Asia and deal with, Buddhism or Taoism or whatever, where reincarnation is an issue, and that's a whole other perspective and philosophy about life. Now, speaking of coping mechanisms, we have to talk about Chris.
Yes. Who, I don't know, Tim was joking, I guess, when you think he's misunderstood.
I think that
Please tell me you
were. So he looks like a psychopath.
Yes.
Who is completely mentally unhinged, ready to kill anyone who he perceives as a threat, including his the only mother figure he has left, Madison. Mm. That said, the writers made it purposefully vague enough in every instance. He could have froze there on the beach. He could have
He's been getting a lot of pleasure out of axing these people in the head of late, the walkers.
He's also had a couple of real breakdowns having to do
that. And
he's also coming off the, if only I'd shot them before they got to the boat, none of this would have happened.
Survivor's guilt.
So I don't believe the freezing at this point.
Yeah, I think he's on that verge of becoming trigger happy, and it's something that we love to see in this show, because it provides this interesting dynamic. He doesn't know the difference now between what it takes to deal with a situation and what it takes to just kind of understand it, but he's experienced both sides of it. He's took the precautions that he had to take. He's seen his father kill his mother, which he thought wasn't necessary, so he was fighting himself back and forth. And then he didn't take action, and in doing so, they ended up getting themselves into an adverse situation. So it's interesting to see how his mind is working. As a young kid, what age is he supposed to be? I believe
17.
He's 17. That's what you have to understand as well. We are so trained to see Carl in The Walking Dead, who just transformed in front of our eyes from a 9, 10-year-old who didn't know the difference between shooting a gun to be shooting people from 40 yards back. So we need to understand that this is a new scenario for this kid, and that he is going to have these complexities, and it makes it interesting to whether or not he is struggling or he's just flipped his switch, like he's just completely gone.
That said, I think Madison is totally in the wrong when she confronted Travis about it.
And really?
Yeah, well, she said, you know, he's out of control. You need to do something about your son.
What about
you,
Nick?
You need to talk. And yeah. It was like, well, I've been there for your kids like every step of the
Before
way.
Before things went
like,
crazy.
Let's be on the same page here. We're not fighting here. What are you doing?
Yeah, but it's like, it's one thing like, okay, my son's a drug addict. Help me go rescue him from this rotting church. To your son tried to murder my daughter. I don't know that there's quite a tit for tat there. I think it is a thing where if this whole problem started because he didn't save Madison when he could have, it's not now Madison's place to nurture him. Like, she's got to go to the one guy left who maybe still can get through to him, which is Travis. And yeah. So, I buy that as an argument. Okay. I think Travis is being a bit of a tit about it.
Can we talk a little bit about Daniel? So, he's still the most interesting character to me, as I said there. But so the scene when they are having to discard of the choir boys and all of the characters that they came by from the church, he was holding one of them by the neck, and he got a flashback, I believe, to a scene where he had someone by the neck. So we've talked about whether or not he's got a dark past. We talked about there is certain instances that we were given snippets of in season one, but I really want to know what is the dark secret behind this character.
They are really teasing out the eventual Daniel episode.
I think so. That's when it's going to happen.
Death Squad flashbacks.
It's interesting to see how him and Chris are probably, they're fighting a very similar battle. They're both struggling to grasp what they need to do to make things right or to avenge their past in this world. And he's not, for someone who it seems he's been experienced in this before, as you mentioned before, maybe there's going to be some war instances in the past where we've seen him take drastic actions, but he's now struggling. He froze as well in a similar situation and had to rely on his daughter to come in and kill the Walker. By the way, which was, again, proven that the Fear the Walking Dead have complete balls. They don't care. They're showing kid walkers all over the place, just getting siphoned down now. They have no problems in doing that.
But the characters have a problem doing that.
Yeah, the characters.
We saw they were really affected by
burying the sick ones. We're the sick ones that's already watched it, and we're like, wow, this is interesting.
It's not the kill squad of season six of The Walking Dead. Yeah. No problem with that.
Yeah. So.
Has the coin come up before? I'm trying to remember.
No, the coin is just that Mexican Santa Muerte iconography. The owl is a symbol of the messenger, so he wanted to send a message. Back, which is why the owl is watching above the little prayer area.
Oh, yeah, right, in the tree. Yeah. So why does it matter then that Daniel throws it overboard? Is there some reason that he's rejecting this?
I mean, that's a good question. I don't think that was explicitly explained in the episode why he did that.
So we think that's in the thing that will come up later.
Yeah, other than to reject that sort of belief system.
I see. Gotcha. I thought it was interesting also when there's the conversation with Nick about when's the last time you were in a church.
Yeah,
and I was like, I knew, and the show was like right there too. So that again, sort of tying
it
in,
hand-holding, but that's fine.
A little bit, you're allowed a flashback.
It's like 17 episodes.
Exactly. Yeah, that was what last season. Who knows?
Yeah.
But I thought that, but again, it ties it into the whole all of the other religious iconography of this show, and it sort of reestablishes the sort of the pilot, the setup for all of this, maybe less as this is a cool location. And more, this is going to be an ongoing metaphor, for this series.
Do we believe Nick was drinking Celia's Kool-Aid there at the end and believing what she was saying? Because it looked like he was, but that's not a little out of character for Nick.
He's also on a journey.
We talked about how he seemed to be thriving in this world at some point. He loved his whole double agent status, and that's why I'm interested when he came into the kitchen was like, I'm done killing. Like, I know no one should be just enthralled with killing unless it's Chris at the moment, but he seemed to be making strides in this world, which we have seen with other characters in the previous show, but now he just kind of takes a couple steps back, and he's like, all right, I'm just done with this. He doesn't know where he's going to be, where his place is.
But that also brings up the idea of, is killing walkers his new addiction? And if it is, can he walk away from it easily?
I don't know. Well, he didn't seem to be enjoying, like, they're not supposed to just showcase that they're enjoying it, but he didn't seem to be as efficient in the pack of walkers as
you thought. Let me say, maybe not killing them, but the adrenaline of the situation, where even if they have found a place of relative safety, he may begin to chafe against that if he's not getting his sort of periodic endorphin rush out of this.
Yeah, I honestly thought it was going to be the sense that he needed to feel needed and he needed to be put into these situations because he wanted to constantly go. I'm going, Mom, you're staying. I'm going to go and be the double agent.
Because he felt he was the guy who needed to be rescued.
Yeah,
so
of course,
often.
And that's why. So he, kind of, I think he liked that responsibility, and that's why I was interested. It was like we were going one direction with him, and then we just came way back. We took a U-turn, and he's now on the verge of being a little vulnerable again, which is needed, and it's always interesting to see. So he maybe will rely on Celia, who is an interesting character,
to say the least.
Yes.
All right. You know.
So next episode, either the villa collapses under its own weight with the group here, or it establishes itself as a long-term setting for the rest of the season.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I know, we're off the boat, so it's anybody's ball game now.
Yeah.
See you next week.